name is Charles Watt, and we're going to talk about energy and utilities. So, an overview of the energy sector. It represents 5.5% of the S&P 500, 4.9% of our SIP holdings. We hold Chevron and Valero Energy. So we are underweight by 0.6%. And includes the oil, gas, consumable fuels, and energy equipment and services industries. And that's the support people and equipment for drilling and refining companies, is what that is. So that is a picture from FinViz, which part of it's chopped off. That's the major companies in the oil and gas industries, effectively. So Chevron is this one right here. And then Valero is one of those that got cut off down there, unfortunately. and then, so it has poor performance compared to the S&P 500 over the last 5 years. The S&P is the orange line, and the energy spider is the green line. So, about 17%. We're talking about mine. On the oil and gas industry generally, performs worse when the worse when the economy is doing worse overall. It, as it is cyclical, and it really only gets going in the later stages. So now is when it's going to start really getting in here. Historically, it does really well in the later stages, so it's going to start getting moving. Really should be doing better about now. This is going to be when energy sees its highest returns, historically speaking, according to Fidelity. Doesn't seem very high though, anyway. Some special metrics used are the price per flowing barrel, which is the market cap of the company, plus debt minus cash, divided by the production barrels per day. And then also the EV of the company divided by the proven reserves, plus probable reserves. So that's the amount of oil they have that they know is in the ground, plus what they think is in there. It's what they have a 50% chance of finding. So if there's a 50-50 shot of finding X million barrels of oil, then they're allowed to declare that as a probable reserve. Proven as a 90% chance. And then also is EV to debt-adjusted cash flow, which is cash flow from operations plus financing costs after tax. Those are the special metrics for this one. Some notable large companies in the sector are ExxonMobil and BP. You guys heard of them. Some economic indicators and profitability drivers for specifically our companies, but the sector as a whole are political stability for the regions and just getting to the oil in general. So this is countries with the largest oil reserves in millions of barrels. So most of these countries, not very stable places as a general rule. Or if they are, it's because they have a large U.S. military presence. So Venezuela right now, been in the news a lot, specifically with Chevron and Valero. They're two of the five foreign companies that are allowed to drill there. They have minority stakes. A lot of government stuff going on with Venezuela. It has large proven reserves. We're going to talk about that more in a little bit. When we get to five forces. So, as we see, the U.S. economy is entering the later stages, so we should see high returns for energy. So, climate change is a major factor that's impacting the industry. All pretty aware that that's from oil and gas industry. That's going to impact the energy industry. That's going to cause a decrease in it. Switching away from oil, going to natural gas. five horses. The revenue entrance is medium, with some areas offering subsidies, like Alaska. We offer subsidies to get new companies into the market, or sponsor their own, like Venezuela. They have, they completely nationalized it, and so 60% of all Venezuelan oil is pumped out by their own company, which is essentially the Venezuelan army. But the major players are usually fairly stable outside of things like that. The power of buyers are low. Oil is oil, no matter where it comes from. Power suppliers is medium. They're really set up to do that. Can't really do anything else with the specialized equipment. The Strider substitutes is medium. Things that you can replace some things, like you can start driving an electric car. I use Fairbanks as an example. I know we use coal here. But, for example, you use oil to make plastic. And the competitive rivalry is high. The competition amongst the numerous companies is very fierce. So
what has been the number one factor impacting oil prices in the last, say, 5 years?
Number one factor in the last 5 years?
If you're going to look at these, what do you think? What has been keeping oil prices have been, well, how have oil prices been performing for the last 5 years?
They've been going down recently. They've been kind of, I'm not actually sure what they've been.
So you might want to look at oil prices, because your entire sector, even though there are things that are not just oil in the energy sector, really is driven by oil price, right? And a lot of these companies, even if they're primarily oil and gas companies, they may do some other things as well, like some of these diversified companies also have renewables, et cetera, but they really are, their bread and butter is oil and gas. So your sector really needs to, if you're covering the sector, you need to follow oil prices. Last 5 years, oil prices have been lower than you would have expected if you were just trying to balance supply with demand. The reason why we look at oil as a cyclical industry, energy is a cyclical industry, is when the overall economy is doing better, fuel is a key input to almost every part, other sector of the economy. You need to transport stuff, make stuff. It all requires oil, right? But liquefied natural gas has become a huge substitute, thanks in part to fracking, etc., and has really kept oil prices depressed, because there's now this huge substitute good that's available for many of the same applications as oil. So it's a trend that's likely to continue. It's something that if you're covering this sector, you need to understand which companies, oftentimes the same companies that have bets on liquefied natural gas and on oil, but you need to understand the role of liquefied natural gas and what it's been doing to overall prevailing oil prices. Okay?
So they represent 3.1% of the S&P 500, 5% of the SIP holdings. So we're overweight by 1.9%. That's okay. We're going to talk about why. Those are the companies we have. We have NextEra and DTE, which are, you can take a cut off, which are this one and this one here. Includes the electric, water, gas, and multi-utility, which is just utilities that have more than one of those together. Someone understands what those are. So they need an explanation of what those are.
Does it include solar?
Yes, as well as independent power and renewable energy. So GDEA, for example, would be included in those, because they have some renewable energy. They have a wind farm out of Eva Creek. They're also an independent power producer. Comparable performance to the S&P 500 over the last 5 years. S&P is the orange line, and they tracked pretty closely for a while, and the Spider is the green line, and then they're starting to track pretty closely at the end. And this is a defensive industry, because everybody needs utilities, every business needs utilities. Not too many businesses do well when they're power and water gets shut off. And in most states, it is also illegal to sell homes that do not have running water or power hookups. Alaska is an exception to that, obviously. We get a dry cabin here. It doesn't really have a peak season in terms of the business cycle. The best one is recessions for this, though. It will outperform others generally by about 15%. There's an emphasis on debt loads, so we want to look at things like the interest ratio, debt to equity, the current ratio, ROIC, and then the electrical load as a percentage of capacity. That's just going to tell us if they're going to need to expand some. So if a particular utility is operating at maybe 80 or 90% of capacity all the time, they're probably going to need to take on some more debt to expand soon. They don't really generate enough revenue on their own to fund projects without debt. So some notable large companies, Duke Energy and Consolidated Edison, Con Ed used to supply power to all of New York City. New York deregulated in the late 90s, now there's 200 companies that supply power. So some key drivers of profitability, planning rate changes, low interest rates are key because of all the debt they have to take on, and sufficient investment in infrastructure. If you don't lay the power lines before you need it, if your city's going to grow, you can't just put them in overnight. And an emerging trend in this industry is against climate change. You can't build more coal plants, for example, if the regulations that are going to affect that are going to say, no, you have to use natural gas or nuclear. For example, Germany's begun phasing out their coal plants. We are going to start shipping more coal to Germany. I just read an article about that. They closed down all their coal mines, so we're going to ship ours to them. We ship most of our natural gas overseas. We ship lots of products out there. That's going to change what types of utility companies, what they use to generate power. It's a different slide than last time. It looks the same, I know. It's different though. The blue bubble that represents the U.S. is actually slightly further up than last time. It's going to enter a recession at some point, but apparently not. So according to both the Fed and Fidelity, this is their one from this year. They just released it a couple days ago. And they're saying that this stage is supposed to last a year to 18 months, historically. But we haven't made this move in a year. The last slide was from the reading last week. And then they just released this slide last night, a couple days ago. And we actually backed up. And they attribute that, as does the Fed, to the impact the Tax Act had on the economy. So apparently it jolted us backwards. So we're not going to go into a recession yet. So
I ask you guys to learn a little bit about the economy, not because I want you to time the next recession, because even professional economists get that wrong. The Fed gets it wrong. People get it wrong all the time. But to generally give some thought about where we are in the economic cycle, not to try and figure out if we're going to enter a recession tomorrow, but to be aware that it is a possibility in the next few years and that we're not in a place where we're recovering. So be generally aware. I don't expect you to be able to time recession, and you shouldn't be making your investment recommendations entirely based off of this chart. There are other trends and other things that impact everyone's sector beyond just where we are in terms of the economic or the business cycle that you need to be aware of. And so if this is the only thing driving your recommendations, you're not doing your job covering your sector. Okay?
So there are the five forces. Power buyers is medium. buyers are the end users of power, and they don't generally have pricing influence unless they're a major installation or an association of buyers, which is increasingly more common in the city. A bunch of people get together, like a homeowners association or just a conglomeration of people in like a neighborhood. Power suppliers in the medium, some specialized equipment, around a hydroelectric dam, some other ones, mass producer, just like a big oil generator, lots of people like those. The threat of new entrants is low, extensive regulations and capital investments required, generally keeps people out of the market there. The threat of substitutes is low. You can hook up a solar panel, you can go off the grid. That's not really viable for people that live in cities, though. You can't really do that. And the competitive rivalry is medium. Most companies only operate in one market. Several larger companies operate in multiple markets and engage in competition there. Intermarket competition within New York City, I mentioned they have 200 companies, is stronger than intramarket, like from New York City over to like New Jersey or in Pennsylvania. Just because there's more within each individual market. And that is my presentation.
Okay. Questions from the class?
So when you did the energy sector, you said that right now is the time that they're kind of going up. Is that because it's winter?
No. Just the time in the business cycle.
No. Okay.
Just the late stage before we hit the recession.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So one last comment on business cycles. Okay, so there's seasonality, and you definitely see that in, like, for example, utilities, right? Everyone here knows that in Fairbanks, we use probably more power or more resources to heat your home in the winter than you're going to use in the summer, right? So there's seasonality to this industry. Cyclicality as well. When we're talking about the energy sector, it's really driven by oil prices almost more than business activity. So while it's certainly cyclical, because the more economic activity there is, the more demand there is for energy and other inputs, the availability of substitutes such as liquefied natural gas has really kind of changed that relationship a little bit, and that's why you haven't seen energy prices move in conjunction with general GDP growth. So realize that there is some power to that model, but it's not the only thing to look at. Okay, guys? Okay, thank you.